Rudolf Höss was the commandant of Auschwitz, responsible for the death of millions. Perhaps one of the greatest mass murderers in the history of humankind. And prior to his execution, when he was in prison, he wrote memoirs, an account of his life. Those memoirs have since been translated into English and published in a book called The Death Dealer. And when we look at the life of Rudolf Höss, we see that he came from a very devout Catholic home. Both of his parents were very fervent in the practice of their faith. And in his childhood, Höss wanted to be a priest when he grew up. But things happened over the course of his life, and he ended up abandoning his faith. It began perhaps when he was, say, in middle school age, maybe around 7th or 8th grade. And he had misbehaved in school and gotten into trouble. And he, you know, confessed what he did wrong to the priest. When he got home that day, he discovered that his parents knew what had happened. And it seems that the parish priest was the only one who had visited the family home that day. And so he thought the priest must have violated the seal of confession. That began his journey away from the faith. Certainly led to a distaste for the priesthood and abandonment of any vocational call that he was considering. And then later on, when he was serving in the military in the Holy Land, he saw some monks who were selling fake relics. And that was sort of the last straw. And so he completely abandoned and turned away from his faith. Later on, Höss joined the SS, and Himmler appointed him to be the commandant of Auschwitz. He was the founder of this horrible place of death. He was responsible for building the camp and developing efficient ways to kill millions. After the war, Höss was apprehended. He was tried at Nuremberg and sentenced to death. And while he was in prison, he underwent a very profound conversion in his life. He returned to the faith of his youth. He returned to Jesus Christ. He wrote a rather moving letter to his wife prior to his execution, and I wish to read an excerpt of that for you. Höss wrote, "But that's the way it was. I regret it painfully. During my long and lonely imprisonment, I've had enough time on my hands to think exhaustively about my life. I have thoroughly reviewed every aspect of my actions. Based on my present knowledge, I can see today clearly, severely and bitterly for me, that the entire ideology about the world in which I believe so firmly and unswervingly was based on completely wrong premises and had to absolutely collapse one day. And so my actions in service of this ideology were completely wrong, even though I faithfully believed the idea was correct. Now, it was very logical that strong doubts grew within me, and whether my turning away from my belief in God was based completely on wrong premises. It was a hard struggle. But I have again found my faith in God. Should you in your misery, my dear good Mutz, find through the Christian faith strength and consolation, then follow the urge of your heart. Don't be led astray by anything. During the time of his imprisonment, Hus was visited by a priest and had the opportunity for confession and knew the great mercy of God. And the editor of the book writes the following description of the last moments of Hus's life. The editor writes, Rudolf Hus, the death dealer of Auschwitz, is asked if there is anything he would like as a last request. He requests a priest and a cup of coffee. Father Lohn is present to hear his confession again. Getting the coffee proves much more difficult. The call goes out to find some coffee. Finally, a Polish woman volunteers that she has some American coffee and dutifully goes off to prepare it. Time is speeding for Hus, but agonizingly slow for the officials and the witnesses. Wrists bound, hands folded in prayer, Hus whispers his confession. His muffled sobbing slices the silence. The officials gaze at their timepieces as a minute hands grind on from point to point. Father Lohn signals that he is finished. The coffee is served. Hus slowly sips the hot liquid. The judge now asks if there's anything else that Hus would like. Fighting to control himself as the tears fill his eyes, Hus answers, Yes, I would like to send my kindest regards to my wife and children. I also ask the Polish people to forgive me for what I have done to them. Almost 2 hours have passed since his first request. Hus puts down the cup and indicates that he is ready. As he rises, he speaks his final sentence. I am very sorry for what I have done to the Polish people. I ask that they forgive me. And so dies Rudolf Hus, perhaps the greatest mass murderer in the history of the human race. Hus dies in the bosom of the church. He dies reconciled with God. Here in his life, we witness an incredible outpouring of the mercy of God. Because God loved the world, and he gave his only Son that we might not perish. He gave his only son that Rudolf Hess might not perish. He gave his only son that you might not perish. He sends forth his love and his mercy upon us all. There is no sin too great for God to forgive. Through the death and resurrection of our Lord, we can have ultimate confidence in the Lord's mercy. And that is why it says in the image of divine mercy, Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in your mercy. My sins do not have the last word. I put my life in your hands, and I entrust myself to your care and to your mercy. It seems that in our life, we might experience three fundamental obstacles to the mercy of God. The first obstacle is that we wonder if it's possible for us to be forgiven. The second is that we might have great difficulty forgiving ourselves. And we beat ourselves up again and again and again for the sins of our past. And the third is that we might have great difficulty forgiving others who have sinned against us. And so, as a remedy for the first obstacle, that disbelief perhaps that we could be forgiven, just look at the life of Rudolf Hess. And if the Lord can pour forth his mercy upon him, he can pour forth his mercy upon you. It gives God no greater delight than to forgive you. It gives him no greater delight than to forgive you. Think of the parable of the prodigal son and the joy with which the father welcomes his son when his son returns home. It gives God no greater joy than to forgive you. As a remedy for the second obstacle and the difficulty that we sometimes have forgiving ourselves, it is helpful just to rest in the Father's love. It is helpful just to rest in the Father's love. God doesn't love you because of what you do. God loves you for who you are. God doesn't love you because of what you do. We don't earn God's love. God's love cannot be earned. He loves you for who you are. And when he looks at you, he sees someone he absolutely delights in. when the Lord looks at you, he sees someone he absolutely delights in. We do not merit, we do not earn God's love. He bestows it generously, he bestows it freely, and he bestows it with great delight. So if you ever find difficulty forgiving yourself and you find that you're falling into a trap, beating yourself up over sins of the past, just simply go to confession, confess your sins, leave your sins there, and rest in the love of the Lord. The third obstacle to the Lord's mercy that we sometimes experience is a great difficulty that we have in forgiving people who have harmed us, especially if the hurt is deep. And the remedy, once again, is the healing balm of God's love. No self-help book will completely heal us of the wounds of our heart. But God's love does. And it's the healing of these wounds that gives us the strength and the compassion and the mercy to let go of the pain of our heart, to let go of the bitterness, to let go of the anger, to let go of the fear, and to reach out a hand in forgiveness to those who have harmed us. So if you are suffering from any of those wounds of sins that people have committed against you, come to the Lord. Come to receive his love. And the great font of that love for the healing of wounds is the Holy Eucharist that we adore here before us and which we receive when we celebrate Holy Mass. Because on this very altar we can lay all the hurts of our heart, all the wounds of our heart, we lay on the altar. And from the altar, we receive the Holy Eucharist, the very presence of Christ, the healing gift of his love. And we receive him into our life and into our heart. And we ask him to let his love wash over us. So if you are suffering from these wounds, I just encourage you as often as you can to adore the Lord in his Blessed Sacrament and look on him who loves you. Look on him who loves you. Look on him who loves you. And every time you receive Holy Communion, invite the Lord deeper into your life and let his love heal you. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, that we might not perish. This day let us claim the Lord's mercy. Let his love wash over us. And let us say, Jesus, I trust in you.